real quick. Steve and I are different than Raphael, and I'm different than I was last semester, for those of you who had me last semester. So, clues for your lab practical. Confidence.
I am so ready for this.
Okay. You know what you know. Okay, you know what you know. It's very simple. Okay, we have confidence in what, but we can't take it out of us and give it to you. That's your job. So, how many of you know Edward Yu?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, some of you know Edward. Did he ever tell you about him and his practicals?
No.
Oh, I made him scream, "I got this." You know, and everybody else had to agree that he really meant it from down, in here, right from the gut. "I got this," you know. That's what we had to have him do because he was a rep. Okay, some of you that cried last semester, Raphael would give you a chance to let you breathe and whatnot and, you know, and let you move forward. Okay, we know you knew this, okay? But it's like the first time you did competency. You were nervous, okay? Get over it. Right, really, you're a little over a quarter away through the program. I mean, if you're not over it now, you're in a world of hurt. Okay, just get over it. Okay, have confidence in yourself. You didn't study as much as you'd like to. Well, you know what you know. So, psh, give it up. It's no point. Oh my God, I should have studied more. Oh my God.
That's funny.
Okay, this is not going to help you. You know, so you're going to have to trust yourself always. We know you know more than you know. That's why I push you in image analysis. Some of you really love me doing image analysis, especially if you didn't have me last semester. You're like, oh my gosh, you know. And yes, I have people crying during image analysis. I don't feel bad, but I feel sad for you. You know, but the other hand is, if it evokes that much emotion, then you must have something that is critical for what you're doing right now, and that's passion. Oh my gosh, if you don't have passion, you cannot do this. You know, you can't do this. So, you know, remember, I have a passion for this. This is what I want. Okay, I am committed. You know, and then you move forward. Because we're gonna get you through it. Oh, I'm sorry, there's this other little word I need to put down here.
Yeah.
You do have to do a little bit of study. You know, on that one. You know, and the other piece, and this is a hard thing. To think about, because look, you spent 4 years getting here, right? Mm-hmm. Well, maybe a couple of you only spent two, but most of you spent 4 years getting here, getting to this moment in time, mm-hmm. with this as your single direction, okay? And sometimes we find out that I've arrived where I want to be, oh my gosh, but it's really bad timing. You know, my life was not the way it was 4 years ago, or 2 years ago. It's so different, it's so overwhelming, you know, and I'm trying to juggle, okay? And you're juggling fireballs, you know, icicles. You know, so you gotta juggle those things really fast so you don't get burned or you don't get stuck with them. You know, and sometimes it's just, you can't manage it in this moment. And that's okay too. All it says is you are recognized where you are in this moment, and then you make another decision. Okay, because you know from previous students, you've got the rules that we will work with you. Okay, you've been doing everything you're supposed to do. We will work with you. Okay, we're going to help you. We, you know, come up with, you know, plans and things. So, because we want you to be successful, we pull out and invest in you. We've done a lot. So just as you've given up so much in your life, okay, and even though it's part of our job, we don't have to be this way. No, every year we get somebody that says, well, I want to go there because you're really nice and you don't kick people out. And I'm thinking, you'll get kicked out. Because that's not the attitude I want, you know. And I'm like, no, we don't do that. But, you know, so, you know, here's another one. Be kind to yourself. Be gentle. You know, all of you have been beat up enough. You know, if you knew the things that I was called by my dad coming up, you would know why I tried to be. I was close to the perfect child as you can get. Okay, because it was so painful hearing those words. You know, they were so awful. So, you know, I had to learn to be gentle with myself, but there's times now, I did it this morning. Oh, you stupid idiot, what's wrong with you? You got poop for brains? You know what I'm saying? Okay, that's not me, that's not my work. So, you know, be gentle with yourselves, because you're the only ones that can do it. Okay, we have faith in you, we trust you, you know, so go get them. So what do you have to do? You have to read every word. Read every word. And as I told you before, there are distractors, which means there are going to be mistakes on there. So if you don't do do everything just like you do in the hospital, then, you know, you may have an issue. I guarantee you will. And the patient's card doesn't know what you're going to do. It doesn't say REO stomach on there. They don't know what you're going to do, so they can't help you this semester. Yay! Because some of you kind of ease yourself into the position. Okay, you get your hand out of the way. I got you on tape. You know, so just read every word. Read. You know, and when you have time enough to, you know, get your thoughts together, and then, you know, it's your organization. You know, don't want to forget to set the technique. Don't want to forget to shield it. You know, the basic things that you already did last semester. Okay, and today's group, do your classmates the hugest, most gigantic favor you can possibly do them. Don't discuss your practical with them. Okay? I may change all the cards. You never know about me. Okay, because the poor Monday and Friday, I mean, Friday's going to really get hosed because they lose another Friday. You know, so theirs are really stretched out. You know, so the Wednesday group, since there's no, you know, holidays and flex days and all that kind of stuff, Wednesday group goes right on. And whereas the other Monday and Friday, you know, you lose days. You know, Monday's lost 2 days already, Friday's lost a day, it's going to lose another day. So don't discuss the practical level. And I'll tell you what, you don't know. Okay. Any questions before we get on to this lecture? All right, we left off somewhere. And by the way, if you didn't get a chance to print these out and you want them printed out, some of you work really nicely off of your tablets and phones. I don't know how the heck you do it. You know, if you let me know early evening, you know, 5 or 6, or earlier than that, I might get a chance to print some copies, and I was going to print some copies today, but my printer had its own thing going on. Okay, so, how'd you like having those two classes back to back?
It was fun. We watched a movie.
Thank you. That helps. Okay, we were getting on down there to the subjects.
So,
Let me ask a few questions to kind of get some things. On salon, I missed you all. Okay, so, Sabina.
Yeah.
On an RAO cervical spine, which inner vertebral foramen do you see?
You see the left intervertebral foramen the best.
On the RAO?
On the RAO, so that's PA. And then R right here, because it magnifies the left side more.
Rachel, is she correct?
Yes.
Colleen, is she correct?
I would just say closest to the image.
Bingo!
Yeah, that is the,
Okay, if you, I don't know any clues here, but PA closest. AP furthest away. Okay.
AP Jesus. Away. It doesn't rhyme, but that's what we talk.
Okay, on an LPO lumbar spine, what zygapophyseal joints are best demonstrated? LPO lumbar spine. LPO lumbar spine. What zygapophyseal joints are demonstrated best?
Left side.
I asked Jesus. Okay, we're gonna call it self control. Okay. This whole group over here is cheering for you. Okay, I'm gonna get a really hard one for that one. LPO.
The left.
The left. Okay, Dennis, do you agree?
Absolutely.
Okay, do you agree?
LPO.
He answered the question.
Yeah, I feel that it's.
No. Just say which one's right or left, not a whole paragraph.
I feel it'll be the right one.
Okay, it'll be the right one.
I think it again.
You think it's right? Which ones do you think it is?
Away from the IR.
Away from the IR. So you think it's the right one. Okay. Well, let's go and look because we have a disagreement here. Okay, so here's the LPO. Okay, and it's the left zygapophyseal joint, the ones closest. The ones closest. Okay, so Annie, let me check these names off. Because I'm checking your names off here. And which projection? C-spine. What projection can best demonstrate the intervertebral foramen?
Intervertebral foramen is 45.
45 what? 45
oblique part.
Okay, so in the obliques, yes. Okay, everybody hear that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, Sabina didn't because she's back there talking to Hilda, and Hilda hasn't learned how to say, would you turn around and mind your own business because I'm confused enough as it is. So, Hilda!
She was helping me.
Blind leading the blind again. Mm-hmm. Hilda, question for you. Which projection T-spine? What projection do you see the intervertebral foramen? Can't help you now.
The lateral?
Yay! Look at you. See, you don't need her. You all understand I'm kind of messing with you.
That's good.
Okay. For an AP, we're going to give this one to Sarah.
Yes.
She's sitting down and answering the question. Okay, so, Sarah.
Yes.
How many degrees do you angle for the AP axial L5-S1?
Stuff I haven't studied for. I'm going to say 35.
Is she right? Yeah, okay. I didn't study. You know how we are. I didn't study. So why did you say 35?
Because we angled for the rectosigmoid at 35, and I just kind of kept it the same for the same area because there's a similar anatomy.
Okay, whatever works for you. Okay, whatever works for you, and that obviously did. Okay, and something you can remember is just remember that, the curve there. Okay, that's it's a kyphotic curve here, so it's pretty steep. No, but we're talking about the AP axis. So, this one. and I did say AP axis.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. And all right, so let's get into details there. Let me go forward. Okay. So, let's ask Maureen.
I know it.
So that's why you already have the answer. She's ready for me. She has the answer. Okay. So, when we're doing an AP axial, lumbosacral junction, and SI joints, we angle 30 to 35. Okay, why are we given a range?
Because everyone is different. Some people have
everyone be more very specific.
Some people have more.
Not be more specific in that.
Women and men are different.
Yay! Boy, that was fun. She's had blood dripping down her face. Okay, good. Okay, so let's see. Let's go back. Let's look at which one is which.
30 for women.
So no, for women, men, yeah. It's 30. For men, it's 35.
Wait.
We have the opposite.
You have the opposite?
The female symbol.
Is that, do I have it wrong?
No, well, maybe you said
30 for that men and 35 for women.
Oh, I can't read my own sign.
No, that's okay. That's right.
That's right.
Thank you for paying attention.
That looks good. Okay.
All right. So let's move forward. Here. Oh, no, I have another question. Why do you do flexion and extension of the cervical spine? I'm going to ask you the next question. Listen, I'm working on it.
You've been steadily here.
Mobility. Yeah. Is that what you were gonna say, Christina?
Mm-hmm.
Mobility.
Okay.
And you can see the gender changes a lot.
What about whiplash? Would that be for flexion extension too?
Not necessarily.
Okay.
Because with whiplash, it usually, because you have a muscle spasm, it straightens out the curve.
Okay.
All right, so I don't think I had these slides up. So this is your AP axial for L5-S1, AP axial with degenerative changes, and here on the left SI joint. And this one, I'm looking for things that are real obvious because you all are not diagnosing. But when we say degenerative changes, it's kind of nice to know what that looks like. Okay, and this is obvious enough. This is so different from this on this side than it is from here.
Is it like arthritis?
Well, degenerative changes, it can be, we could call it a degenerative joint disease, or we could call it degenerative arthritis. And it's really all the same thing, okay? Because arthritis is pretty much inflammation of the joint. The SI, these are joints, okay? They move. When do these joints move? Monica. When do they move? When we walk? No. When do they move?
The SI joints?
Yeah. It's a joint, so it has mobility.
When you lift up your legs?
Gently?
Balloon?
I know this is your second one.
With your hips?
Sarah?
When we give birth?
Childbirth.
Yeah.
That joint loosens as well as the pubic symphysis. Loosens. Okay, so we have that. All right, I showed you this one because remember with counting that the only angle was, it was 15 degrees. So you need to know this difference. And I want to point out here, yes, we see the sacrum really nicely here because when we're doing sacrum, we do angle 15 degrees. Okay? But we don't see the promontory. So that's going to be your clue if you were to see these two on your exam. Okay, side by side, you have to say which one is which.
Okay. Just schedule for Wednesday.
Next Wednesday? Mm-hmm. Okay. When we get to the end here, we'll see. Because I have it on here. With the day. Whatever's in the... I write this stuff down because I can't remember whether I'm coming or going these days. And, you know, having a quarter of the month is really disturbing. Yes, next Wednesday. And we're having a quiz at Friday.
Next week, huh?
30, more angles.
All right, SI joints.
Is that for this class next week?
Yeah.
Yeah, Wednesday.
Dang, this class.
Yes.
Damn.
I think so.
Okay, next SI joints. We do AP obliques, the shallow obliques, and we're going to see the joint furthest away from the image receptor, which means our collimation will be over the what side of the patient? No, the patient's like this. So where am I going to be centered? If you had to tell somebody what side of the
outside.
Center. The elevated side. Yo, hello.
Oh, okay.
Okay, elevated side. The elevated or upside. We're always telling you the upside. Okay? Both sides are always done for comparison. Okay, so it's an AP oblique. We do an RPO and an LPO bilateral exam. If you were to use a 10 by 12, you put it lengthwise, but most of the time people will do a 10 by 12 crosswise, and they will get both sides because they get confused as to what one's going to be on there. It's kind of like doing the flexures for the BD, right? It's the upside that's best in. So, central ray is at 40 inches, and we are going to center 1 inch medial to the ASIS of the elevated side. So, here's the ASIS. We're going to move medial about an inch. Okay, and there's the SI joint. Now, you want to use close collimation. You can obscure shield males and females. You have to do that very carefully. I still would shield them. And then you're going to suspend respiration at the end of exhalation. Always do the same breathing for both sides. Okay, so here's what it looks like from the top. And that, you know, this is more than an inch, but remember these angles and these pictures are to give you an idea of where it should be. Okay, so the patient is going to be rotated approximately 25 to 30 degrees away from the side of interest because we're looking at the elevated side. You want to use one of the long angle sponges. And this is one I probably would use a sponge because I've got to be really careful with my centering and my degree of obliquity. You always want to ensure patient comfort. Don't drink ensure. And again, it says adjust the patient so the central ray enters 1 inch medial to the elevated side. Keep the long axis in the middle of the table, and from what I'm seeing in lab, you all are getting much better at being consistent with that. That's really good. Mm-hmm. Okay, evaluation, we want that SI joint open. And some of you will notice on your oblique lumbar spines that the SI joint is open. Okay, even though it's 45 degrees, it will still be open. It just won't be as nice as this one. You want to have proper collimation. Ovary is here, but it seems on the left side, so the right ovary is over here somewhere, because here's the pelvic bone. Yeah, so you can shield. If you're really careful, you can shield, you know, both sides. You can use ovary shield for the circle. You want a very slight overlapping of the ilium and the sacrum here. And of course, they always say soft tissue, bony, trabecular detail. Okay, Maureen, what's soft tissue? When you're doing image analysis with me, and you're talking soft tissue, what are we talking about?
Muscle, fat, and skin.
Yay for you. Okay, remember that. Skin, fat, muscle. You need to be able to see those differences. Okay, Cynthia, I've been ignoring you. I'm sorry. What is trabecular detail? What are we really talking about?
Like the cortical bone and the soft, spongy trabecular tissue on the inside. You should be able to see both.
They look pretty much the same. So whenever you're bone detail, this is detail. This is what you're talking about. That's what I want to hear about. Soft tissue. That's what I want to hear, and I want you to point it out. Okay.
Cortical is like the compact bone.
Yeah, cortical or compact. Yes. Okay. All right, subluxation. What is subluxation? I've seen it, Dennis. I've seen subluxation on some of your on your terminology. Remember we talked about spondylosis? Remember what spondylosis was? Well, Monique, let's go back to you. We had a clinical instructor's meeting yesterday, so it's a good possibility that she doesn't get it. What's subluxation? It's like a dislocation, okay, but it's not completely dislocated.
Oh, partial.
Partial. Dislocation would be substantial, and I could have put degenerative changes because that's what we see here. And that is, she doesn't show up well. Let me see if I can fix that a little bit. But not today. Okay. Poor birds, I sit in the backyard this morning. The poor birds are just, they're literally flying around in circles and so forth, you know, because they thought it was spring. Mm-hmm. You know, trees are all in blossom. Mm-hmm. They were sneezing a lot.
Yeah.
I am. And lo and behold, it's not spring. There's this wind, that cold wind this morning. It's terrible. Okay. This one I will get to you by Friday, but I have it. It's in working. So it's in my working file. So welcome back. All right. Hey, okay. Scoliosis and spinal fusion. Okay, now in your textbook, they give you the spinal fusion projections as a part of the lumbar spine. Okay? So, here's a summary of positions. You need to know the thoracolumbar scoliosis, PA, and lateral. Frank et al. That's the one. Frank used to be the lead editor of Merrill's. Oh, let's see if I fix that. And then there's the thoracolumbar spine scoliosis, PA, right and left bending, and a Ferguson method. Then we have our spinal fusion, AP. And the AP is the lateral bending. Let me fix that right away. That's confusing. My apologies. It's not supposed to do that. What's wrong with my computer? The gremlins are attacking. When I wake up in the morning, about a foot of my covers are at the foot of the bed. I'm in the same place. Okay, but like, how do they get there? Does that happen to you? There's a little gremlin down at the bottom of the bed, you know, and I wake up and I'm cold, and it comes up. And it's cold.
It happens today. They get heavy.
What is that?
My duvet cover gets heavy at the bottom, so it'll get heavier and then it like slips off. I know.
Okay, that gives me an idea of what I can do.
I always have to like even it out.
Well, I even it out. I make my bed every night before I get in it. Which means I don't make my bed when I get out. Where is your focus?
Yeah, that's
now your fusion, your spinal fusion, although it's not essential, it is part of what is required on the exam, and it's also what you most likely are going to do in the hospital. This will be helpful. Okay, so you want to know these terms, the methods, because you might see that. You do lateral bending. I think about the only place I've seen. Has anybody here done lateral bending? This one, maybe the VA? No. Children's maybe. I can only remember doing it once or twice. The most common is doing the lateral hyperflexion and hyperextension. That should go up there. Okay, ARRT, AP and PA scoliosis series, Ferguson, that's going to be this one. And then the lumbar AP, right and left bending, lateral flexion extension. The reason it's numbered like this is I'm numbering it exactly the way it is on that list of projections and exams that you haven't looked at that's on the ARRT website. That was good. Just leave that in there. Yeah. Okay, so, this is also, this part here is also, so I have to clean this up. That's why I didn't give it to you. Okay, we're also going to look at sacrum and coccyx. For the sacrum, we're going to angle 15 to 20 degrees cephalad. For the coccyx, we angle 10 to 20 degrees caudate. Oh, that's your biggest challenge, is remembering what way to angle. But think anatomy. Screaming that at the top of my lungs. This is L5. And that's the sacrum. Here's the coccyx. I guess I better make a third one. So if you think anatomy, oh yeah, for the sacrum I have to angle cephalad. oh, the coccyx, because it curves up, nobody has a perfectly straight coccyx. If they did, you probably had a tail when you were born and they cut it off so you never knew that. That's true. That's what you're doing. People are born with, you know, extra fingers and toes. Okay. All right, so if you remember that, your anatomy, and I'm always saying anatomy, 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 you won't have a problem with that. We'll also say doing the lateral sacrum, we can do a lateral sacrum with coccyx combined, or we can do one centered over them. Now, we did go over these. Do you remember? Or just if I looked at the slide so many times that I forgot. Okay. For sacroiliac joints, again, this is ART, AP, posterior oblique and anterior oblique. Okay, so let's see. Okay. Angela!
Yes?
I have to do a PA oblique for SI joints. How am I going to position the patient? Mm-hmm. So this is an APO blood. I talked about an LPO and an RPO.
Okay. So it would be RAO or LAO.
Okay, good.
And angle them about 30.
Okay, 25 to 30. And where are we going to center?
We're going to center about an inch medial to the ASIS.
Okay, but if they're like this,
ASIS.
Well, what side are you going to center over?
The side closest?
Yes. Okay, the downside.
Downside.
The downside. Okay, so we would, since, you know, we could reach around and palpate the ASIS, but we can palpate the ASIS on the upside so that we know the level, right? And then we would center probably an inch and a half lateral to the midsexual pump. Okay, good. Because you're going to get stuff like that. We don't talk about them. Nobody does them that way, but you need to know how. Nobody does them that way here, probably on the entire West Coast. Okay, all right, that you've seen before. Okay, so this is what's important for doing your scope. The first section on these slides are scope. If I said these two, I had no idea that we were coming or going. Okay, so, all right, so when you're doing scoliosis, you want to try and, if possible, look at the prior exam to determine the level of scoliosis, meaning where it is in the patient's body and how much curvature they have. You want to perform PA when possible to reduce radiation to breast, and yes, men have breast tissue. Hello. So, everybody. Now, you need to thoroughly understand your dedicated equipment operation, because some of you have, the VA has dedicated equipment, don't they have dedicated at South City? Yeah, I think South City does, and there's a couple of other places. Know that unit. Know how it works. It's usually they use them for doing leg length as well. So, know your dedicated unit. You could do it on a 14 by 36 image receptor, also known as a long cassette. The VA has these, although they use a dedicated unit. Their chest unit will allow them to do scoli if they're doing full body. At Kaiser Redwood City tomorrow, they have a 14 by 36, and it's in the hallway by the reader. Where you get your portable cassettes. Then another way of doing it is using, and actually I'm going to have 1 to 3 image receptors that must be stitched. Okay, if you use 2 image receptors or more, the patient doesn't move in between the exposures, and you may in part be a dedicated unit. Children is that way. I think Sequoia is that way. Sequoia, have any of you done
They have a 14 by 36, okay. But they also stitch them together.
Okay. So, it has three. Does it have three?
It's two or three.
Well, it will show me tomorrow. I'll be there tomorrow. Okay, so know your equipment. That's the bottom line. And the other way of doing it is just one 14 by 17, and it doesn't need to be stitched, and that's a little bit different. Okay, so the collimation is going to depend on the extent of the patient's scoliosis and the type of imaging equipment you're using. You're going to use 60 to 72 inches to expose the length of a 14 by 36 because you need that diverging ray. You're also going to use it if you're doing a 14 by 17, and I'll show you that later. Okay, what are you going to do to prevent repeats? Clear and concise instructions to the patient. On these dedicated units, the tube usually moves. So I'm standing there, and nobody told me that tube was going to move. What do you think I'm going to do? I'm going to bolt. You're absolutely right. You know, the tube starts moving, I'm out of there. Nobody told me that was going to happen. So involve your patient with the exam. You know, tell them what you're doing and why you need to have them stand still. Breathing instructions are going to vary. Oftentimes, the tech doesn't give them any breathing instructions, and the patient just does shallow breathing. Or they may have them do it on inspiration if it's a type of dedicated unit that adjusts itself quickly. Make sure you've set the correct technical factors and that you've operated the equipment correctly. Now, I will tell you a secret. In fact, it's a well-known secret. And people that remember me at the VA, if I had to do a scoli or a leg length, I would have found another tech. I could not make that unit work. So, and I would have my little notes there trying to figure out, you know, trying to follow those instructions. And I think one time I got it. So operate the equipment correctly. You know, for me, that was always good help. Okay. As students, we expect you to learn how to use it. But, I'm acknowledging that it can be challenging, right? You're laughing at me, aren't you? You're too far away. There we go. Oh, wait a minute. I have a question up there. Wow. Well, we already went over these guys. Okay, scoliosis radiography. So we've got about five more minutes. Okay, the patient should remove all clothing, you know, except their undies. Bras are nice to come off. And they'll remove your shoes when they're in the room. A typical scoliosis exam may include PA, upright, and it can be a PA with the lateral bending. So a PA lateral bending is this. This is lateral, right? So I'm bending laterally. Ooh, that feels good. I'm gonna stretch this morning. A lateral upright with or without bending, and a PA, could be a PA recumbent. The purpose is to demonstrate the amount and degree of curvature that occurs with the force of gravity acting on the body. That's the reason for standing up. There are times when it's also used to evaluate fixation devices such as Harrington rods, and I'm going to show you Harrington rods because some of you have no idea what I'm talking about. Bending studies are used to differentiate between primary and compensatory curves. Primary means the curve that I have when I'm just standing here. And then when we do bending, there's going to be curves that may develop to compensate for the curve, the natural curve that I have that I shouldn't have. Does that make sense? Oops. Okay. All right, so let me quick show you the Harrington rods and give you all a half an hour here. And if I don't get it to you, if you don't get it by email Thursday around 6-ish, then okay, so I don't have Harrington rods there, I'll show that to you. But you know what, all of these things, you can Google them. And that's kind of why I got hung up on this, because I was Googling things and I was watching the surgeries and stuff. All right, so Friday, we're going to finish up what we're doing. Long bone, and we're going to do long bone. That's very quick, so you'll have the, as I said, either I'll send it to you or I'll print it. We have quiz number 2 at the end of the class. Monday, we're going to review all the stuff that we've had so far. And Wednesday, we're going to have an exam. My exams are usually somewhere around 50 questions, And with images, I really loved images in the beginning of, you know, around probably 10-ish images, something like that. True, false, fill in, you know, that sort of thing. And it's designed so that you have to know the information. No, really.
I know.
It's designed, you've got to know it.